Welcome to the Functional Medicine Radio Show with your host, Dr. Carrie Drisga, known internationally as the Functional Medicine Doc. Dr. Carrie is committed to helping patients find the root cause of their health problems and fixing the cause with natural treatments so they can feel normal again. Dr. Carrie is the founder of Functional Medicine Ontario and is the author of the hit book, Reclaim Your Energy and Feel Normal Again. Please welcome your host, Dr. Carrie Drisga.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Functional Medicine Radio Show, the only internet radio show dedicated to giving you real solutions to improve your health. Not only are they real solutions, but they're natural solutions as well, because as you know, the one and only true wealth you have is your health. I'm your host, Dr. Carrie Drisga, the Functional Medicine Doc, and I'm committed to helping you find the root cause of your health problem, fix the cause with natural treatments, so you can feel normal again and live your life to the fullest. Now, today we're talking with Sarah Ballantyne, and this is our third interview together, actually. I'll find the other two interviews and put those in our podcast notes so that you can listen to those. So let me tell you a little bit about Sarah in case you haven't already heard about her. Sarah Ballantyne is the blogger behind the award-winning ThePaleoMom.com site, co-host of the syndicated top-rating The Paleo View podcast, and New York Times best-selling author of The Paleo Approach, The Paleo Approach Cookbook, and The Healing Kitchen. Sarah earned her doctorate degree in medical biophysics at the age of 26, and she spent the next 4 years doing research on innate immunity and inflammation. After her second daughter was born, she began to experiment with the paleo lifestyle. It had an amazing effect on her health. Over time, she healed herself of a long laundry list of physical complaints, including Hashimoto's, fibromyalgia, IBS, acid reflux, migraines, anxiety, asthma, allergies, eczema, psoriasis, and an autoimmune skin condition called lichen planus. Her passion is for providing straightforward explanations for the science behind the paleo diet and its modifications, plus her love of food and cooking and her dedication to her family form the foundations of her blog, her podcast, and her books. Hi, Sarah. Thank you so much for being my special guest today on this episode of the Functional Medicine Radio Show.
Thank you so much for having me back. I feel like three is such a lucky number, right? So I'm like, woohoo, third time's the charm. You know, three wishes, three's great.
Yes, I think it's a very lucky number too. So it's been a while since we spoke last, and our first interview we kind of focused on a paleo diet. Mm-hmm. And you gave us some information behind, you know, your background and your story, all of those, you know, your health challenges and your journey. And then in our second interview, we focused more on the autoimmune paleo diet and how to use that for people who have any kind of autoimmune issue, whether it's Hashimoto's or rheumatoid arthritis or lupus or eczema or psoriasis or whatever it is. And then I think it's been a while. It's been a year or so, maybe more. So can you kind of tell us what you've been working on? Because I know you're a busy lady and you've got all kinds of stuff that you're always working on and nerding out on, geeking out on. And then we'll get into today's interview.
Yeah, so I've really been focused on creating educational resources that help inform day-to-day choices for the average person. So I have a new book that just came out called Paleo Principles, which is, you know, it's branded under the paleo diet, but really it is a deep dive into the medical research to really help us understand the fundamentals of a healthy diet and lifestyle, as well as the flexibility within that template. So really trying to understand what are sort of broad overarching principles that we all need to be aware of, where does bioindividuality come into place, and how does somebody sort of self-experiment in order to figure out what's optimal for them. So that book has been out for a few months now, and it's really a beast. It's almost 700 pages. It's a sort of all-in-one resource, deep dive into the science, but also lots of practical tips and strategies and over 200 recipes and 20 meal plans and everything sort of all-in-one. And then as a sort of tangent to that, I've started getting into creating online courses and really trying to expand the modalities that I'm using to communicate with people. So I've recently launched a course that's focused on the autoimmune paleo diet that we talked about last time on the show. That again, it's sort of, it's designed for everything I do is designed for a general audience. Even though I do these deep dives into the science, I take the time to explain it to somebody without a science background. And so this course is the same, but it's now this combination of like video and slides and, you know, the homework and self-discovery exercises and online discussion groups and things like that to be able to really help people thoroughly understand the whys behind recommendations and get away from a, you know, do this, don't do that set of rules as I progress in this sort of health education, health advocacy career. One of the things that I keep hitting against is this inherent desire for a lot of people to break rules. And when we have sort of arbitrary rules, we tend not to follow them. So really trying to get away from rule-based descriptions of healthy choices and get into a more broad education surrounding why one choice is better than another to really empower choices. So rather than, oh, I know I should do this, I understand what will happen if I choose this, and have that be a really different sort of self-speak when it comes to making our day-to-day choices.
So then let's start there. Let's talk about diet dogma and why rules don't work.
Yeah, it's really interesting. As I was writing Paleo Principles, and I was really trying to get away from a lot of the soundbite descriptions of the paleo diet, I was trying to create a resource that would give people the information that they need to respond and rebut to criticisms of the paleo diet. But I was also trying to, you know, sort of correct course a little bit with this book and talk about some things that have traditionally been considered paleo that maybe don't work for a lot of people, and some foods that have traditionally been verboten but actually probably do work for a lot of people, and try to get away from rules and, you know, here's your list of paleo foods and here's your list of foods to avoid, go. And so I did a bit of a research into just the psychology of rules and rule following. And there's some really interesting studies that have been done, even in sort of the diet sphere, of if you give people, you know, plenty of people know that cake is a junk food, that, you know, cake is not going to make you healthier. And yet if you offer somebody a piece of cake or an apple, even though everybody knows the apple's the better choice, about 60% of people will choose the piece of cake. And so this idea of trying to get beyond I know I should or I shouldn't, because we've got these amazing, very tempting, hyper-palatable, addictive foods that we're trying to lure people away from, and that's a hard sell. And yet we sort of know, no matter what sort of niche within the alternative health community you belong to, we all know that getting away from these super refined, highly processed, very, very addictive manufactured foods is the number one thing that most people can do to improve their health. So how do you get away from, like, I know I should choose the apple, but the cake's tastier, so I'm going to go with the cake. Like, how do you combat that? And, you know, as best I can tell, the better way to combat that is with information. So rather than, I know the apple's healthier, like, why? And if you take a sampling of people and you say, okay, why is the apple healthier? You'll get some responses that will say, well, you know, the cake has more sugar, or the cake has more fat. You might have some people say, well, the cake's made with eggs, and, you know, some people are still in this sort of 1970s belief that eggs are terrible. But at the same time, like, what does the apple have that's better? And that becomes a harder question. Well, it has fiber, quite a lot of fiber. So that's an amazing thing that cake that's made with, you know, white flour is not going to have. It has phytochemicals. Apples are actually one of probably the top food source of antioxidant polyphenols in particular in the average American diet. One apple has about 300 milligrams of polyphenols, which is about the same as like half a bottle of olive oil. Like it really is the dominant source of these important antioxidants for most people. It has a lot more vitamins and minerals. The sugar is going to be a slower burn, so you're going to get less of an insulin spike and less of a blood sugar spike. So we've got all of these other details that we can sort of add. And when you start to talk about that, and then you can start talking about, and when your palate is adapted to not eating cake, that apple is going to taste sweeter and it's going to feel more like a treat. Like, we can layer on this education to suddenly make it, you know, our logical brains can sort of talk over our emotional brains and go, no, wait, here, look at all of this information I've got that's making this apple feel like a more compelling choice. And that doesn't mean that every single person is going to choose the apple every single time. And I think that getting away from dietary dogma also embraces imperfection. But it means that more of us will make the better choice more often. And that, I think, is really how we address all of the sort of crises of public health that we're faced right now.
And then can you talk a little bit about self-experimentation and bioindividuality? Because I see a lot of patients, at least within my office and my private practice, they come in and they've been doing the paleo diet or they've been doing the autoimmune paleo diet and they're stuck. They're not getting better. And so then, you know, I'm just kind of thinking, well, there must be things within that diet that are working for you, but then there might be some things that are not working for you, and that it's not just a black and white kind of thing. It's about trying to figure out the nuances for you, that particular person.
Yeah, so I think that we know that there's been genetic adaptation to agriculture. So in the last, you know, 5 to 10,000 years, the human diet has changed dramatically. There was a fascinating study published, I think early last year, that took genetic samples from teeth from sort of Eastern Europe, and they looked at samples from 6,500 years ago to like 2,000 years ago. So it was from before agriculture hit that area of the world up until, you know, it was very, very well established. And they looked at points of selective pressure on the genome, and they found 12 points of substantial genetic adaptation. The most well understood one was lactase persistence. So this is often used as an example, sort of to counterbalance the paleo soundbite of eating as we're, you know, evolutionarily adapted to eat. There's always this like counter argument of like, well, lactase persistence, clearly we've adapted to changes in diet. And what lactase persistence is prior to milk being part of the human diet, we had no need to make the lactase enzyme, which breaks down lactose sugar in milk, after weaning. So we stopped making it after about the age of 5, which is in traditional cultures the average age of weaning. And when milk got introduced as a food, you know, through animal husbandry, so now we have, you know, dairy cattle or sheep's milk was a more traditional milk source, we needed to keep producing lactase to keep digesting this milk sugar. Otherwise, it was like everybody had lactose intolerance, which is pretty horrible. And we see, depending on when milk was introduced into certain regions, people with a cultural background in those regions will have a different percent or chance of having lactase persistence. So, for example, you see in European descent, you know, 90 to 95% of us have lactase persistence. So only 5 to 10% of us are lactose intolerant. But if you look at some Asian or African descent populations, it almost switches. So only, you know, 10% of some of those populations have lactase persistence and 90% are lactose intolerant. But we can see these points of adaptation. And one of the things that we see is at each point of adaptation, that's where we start to get high variability, because it really depends on our particular genetic heritage and the traditional diets. And because of that, we really need to respect that people are differently adapted to different sort of new foods. But underlying all of that are these rules that we know are universally true. So we know, for example, there's nutrients in foods that we need enough of for all of the processes in our bodies to function optimally. So nutrient sufficiency, meaning we get enough of the full complement of essential and non-essential nutrients from our food, becomes a really important criteria for a health-promoting diet. So we have these like underlying rules, but within that, you know, there's a lot of different ways to get a nutrient-sufficient diet. There's a lot of different ways to eat an anti-inflammatory diet. And there's a lot of foods that are going to fall into this influence of genetic adaptation where some people are going to do well with that food and some people aren't. And even if you could get into, you know, what's your cultural heritage, for example, if you're European, you're more likely to do well with grass-fed dairy. If you have African or Asian descent, you're less likely. But even within that, it's really tough to determine if somebody's going to do well with that food without giving them the tools to self-experiment, which means elimination and challenge protocols. So what I've done in Paleo Principles and the way that I've gone in a lot of my public speaking and discussions on this topic is we've got these foods that we sort of universally know are a health-promoting food, so the most nutrient-dense foods on the planet. And that doesn't mean you can't develop an allergy or a sensitivity to those foods. There's certainly people those foods will not work for, or at least some of them. But we've got this sort of collection of really health-promoting foods that we know have very few problematic compounds in them and tons of nutrients. We have this collection of foods that are really just empty calories, even though they're, it could be called whole foods, like whole grains really don't have a lot of nutrition. Those aren't going to add to most people's diets, and they have more inflammatory compounds, so they're not going to work for a lot of people. And then we have this range of foods in between that people are going to be more sensitive to in terms of whether or not that food works for them or doesn't. And so let's respect that, you know, there's a difference between different people in terms of how their bodies are going to respond to, especially these middle ground foods, but really anything on the spectrum. And the way that we really determine if a food is working for us is by cutting it out for 2 to 4 weeks. That provides time for the body to downregulate any adaptive mechanisms. So, for example, if a food is really disrupting our gut barriers, our mucus-producing cells in our guts will produce more mucus. When that food is no longer in our diet, those cells don't need to produce excess mucus, mucus production goes down. And then when we challenge that food, meaning we try a little bit to see how it goes, well, we don't have that adaptation of extra mucus anymore. So the reaction is going to be magnified. And it's not, elimination challenge doesn't create food sensitivities, food reactions, but it unmasks them. So it allows us to see something that was happening all the time before. And it really only takes a couple of weeks of cutting a food out of our diet completely. And then we just try a little bit of it. There's some, you know, really great protocols for sort of systematically testing these foods, which I definitely recommend when we're talking about suspecting multiple foods as being the culprit. But we can sort of challenge that food, to try out that food, see how it works for us. And typically that protocol, it really is the gold standard for identifying food sensitivities, even allergies. Like there's no testing that for food allergies or food intolerances that can detect every way that we can respond to a food. And even detecting something like an allergy, there's quite a high false positive and quite a high false negative rate with those testings. So this becomes, even for an allergist, this becomes the, and now we verify these results with an elimination and challenge protocol. We can do that by, even though we're bypassing the testing, just by saying, hey, these foods are more likely to be culprits. Let me try cutting them out and let me try systematically adding them back in one at a time. And when we empower people with that information, like here's, you know, why are these foods in the middle? Why might they work for you, but not maybe won't work for you? And then here's how you figure it out for yourself. You really give people the tools to understand their body. And when people understand their bodies better, then all of a sudden you have a different dialogue when it comes to cake versus apple, because you not only have that intellectual, the apple's got more antioxidants and more fiber, but you have the, and I feel crummy when I eat cake, to sort of layer on top of it. And it becomes a really, really empowering amount of information for people to live their lives by.
So although you were initially talking about genetics behind our, you know, body's ability to eat certain foods or not eat certain foods, there's no genetic test to do for any of this. And,
right.
And as you say, with food sensitivity testing, there are an umpteen number of ways that the immune system can have a reaction to a food. Mm-hmm. And that's why running food sensitivity like blood panels they're really tricky. I mean, sometimes there's things that come back and they're true and sometimes false, and it's an expense.
And so it can be a good starting place for some people, but you're right. It just, all of those results need to be taken with a pretty big grain of salt.
And so really the moral of the story is it still boils down to eliminating the food and then doing a challenge.
Correct. And I think also there's beyond the genetic factor in terms of how our bodies will respond to a food or a food group or a certain macronutrient proportion. There's other things that influence how our bodies respond to food. So, for example, a stress level can make a really, really big difference to how our bodies respond to food. It can ramp up the immune system in sort of a dysfunctional way. So stress is inflammatory. Stress also negatively impacts gut barrier integrity. So that means that when the immune system is primed and the gut barrier isn't as good at keeping things out of the body that should not get into the body, you can have more food antigens. So that's like not as broken down food proteins get into the body where the immune system is primed and it can learn to respond, you know, it can learn to react to those foods. So you can develop food intolerances just by being very stressed. Overtraining does something very similar. Inadequate sleep does something very similar, and nutrient deficiencies also does something very similar. There's certain nutrient deficiencies that are inflammatory, that prime the immune system, that they're nutrients that are really important for gut barrier health. And so when you're deficient in sort of vitamin A, vitamin D, zinc, these types of nutrients, you have a leakier gut, the immune system is primed, it can't regulate itself as well. And so we have also these other environmental factors that can influence how our individual bodies will respond to a food. And what's really interesting about these other individual factors is that they're a moving target, they change. So we can change our diet to be a, you know, gut healing diet that promotes a diverse and healthy gut microbiome, that's a very anti-inflammatory and nutrient-dense diet. We can address stress and sleep and activity levels. So we're, you know, promoting gut health, we're regulating our immune systems better, and then suddenly a food that didn't work for us before can start working for us. And that sort of is a whole separate system from the genetic influence.
So for the listeners out there, you can hear that this is complicated. It's
yes.
It's not simple. There's so many different factors. And I know so many of you are struggling and you've tried these things or you want to, but it's, oh my God, it just seems so daunting. It seems so complicated, so difficult. Sarah has been working on her book and her online courses, Keeping Yourself Busy,
yes.
to help all the people out there that are kind of in this kind of in this area where they're just like, they don't really know what to do next, or they're afraid of what to do next. Sarah, can you talk about what are those foods that are kind of in that gray zone that may or may not be creating an issue with somebody's health?
So some of the sort of hot foods, right? And they're it's interesting how these foods really fit. You know, I come from the paleo community, but some of these foods are traditionally considered paleo foods. So the first one I'm going to mention that it's typically considered paleo, but actually doesn't work for a lot of people is vegetables of the nightshade family. So that's tomatoes, peppers, eggplant, potatoes, chilies. So a lot of sort of any spices with heat typically fall into this family. And they have, you know, it's a really interesting sort of in-between food because they have some really compelling nutrition, right? We're always talking about the lycopene in tomatoes and how great that is. But at the same time, vegetables in this, and they're actually, you know, vegetable-like fruit. So let's, okay, fruit in this family are sort of inherently high in a variety of very inflammatory compounds. So just tomatoes by themselves have tomato lectin, which is an agglutinin, a type of lectin that is very, very good at tricking the gut barrier into bringing it into the body and stimulating the immune system. It has alpha-tomatine, which is a glycoalkaloid. Again, it's very, very good at tricking the gut barrier into bringing it inside the body and stimulating the immune system. And both tomato lectin and alpha-tomatine have been investigated for use in vaccines as adjuvants. So that's the chemical that you add to a vaccine to ramp up our antibody production against whatever that sort of dead virus is in that vaccine. So it's, you know, critical for making vaccines work, but maybe not something we want to get from a garden salad. And it also has a couple of other glycoalkaloids like alpha-caconine and a small amount of alpha-solanine. So it has these very, very inflammatory compounds wrapped up in this quite nutritious little package. And it's, you know, no wonder that tomatoes were considered a toxic food until a few hundred years ago. They're, you know, women would be accused of being witches if they cooked with tomatoes just a few hundred years ago. So this entire family has these compounds that can be problematic. There's a type of steroid in hot peppers. It's responsible for the heat in hot peppers that can really super aggravate any kind of mucus lining. So it can actually sort of make, you know, if you're consuming enough of it, if you're particularly sensitive, it basically damages the entire lining of the digestive tract and just makes it really raw. It's like sandpaper almost. And so this whole family can be quite inflammatory. Some people are differently sensitive. And so it's a food that's sort of, you know, on its surface, when you look at just the nutrients in it, it looks like such a great choice of foods. I mean, tomatoes are delicious. They're traditionally considered paleo, and yet they really are quite inflammatory and can sort of exacerbate a chronic illness and autoimmune disease for a lot of people. So that's one sort of group of foods that I would put in this category. I would put a grass-fed dairy, which I already mentioned, in this category. Sort of beyond the lactase persistence issue, there are four proteins in dairy which are highly immunogenic. So we have a very high likelihood of developing allergy or food intolerance against those proteins. And I mean, a lot of the issues with dairy really only applies to homogenized conventional dairy. So we've got, for example, some links between homogenized conventional dairy fat and cardiovascular disease. So there's some interesting things there. That the cancer links with dairy are not very clear, and not at the science. That science needs a lot more information before we can draw some conclusions. But a lot of those arguments sort of fall apart as soon as you talk about sort of an unhomogenized grass-fed dairy where really high in vitamin A and D and K2, and it still is mineral-rich, and it has conjugated linoleic acid, which is an amazing cardioprotective, cancer-protective, and obesity-protective, the type of naturally occurring trans fats, like a super cool thing. So that's another, you know, food that has some pros and cons. It has, that definitely has a genetic factor in terms of how our bodies respond to it. So I would put that in that category. I would put all of the top 8 allergens would go into this category. Rice definitely goes into this category. So all of the foods that we know can, if you're intolerant to gluten, they have a higher likelihood of the antibodies you make against gluten also binding with a protein in these foods. So that would include rice, dairy, soy. A lot of the gluten-free grains fall into this category. Quinoa falls into this category. Buckwheat and amaranth fall into this category. So the pseudograins fall into this category as well. Traditionally prepared legumes. So legumes, again, have more inflammatory compounds, but they really have a compelling amount of fiber and minerals. And where they're traditionally prepared, so they're soaked for a long period of time and then cooked sort of low and slow for a long period of time, that deactivates a lot of the problematic compounds in legumes. It makes the minerals more easily absorbed by our bodies. That's a food I would put in this category as well. And that's another one that's not considered traditionally paleo, but it can work for a lot of people, and there's some compelling nutrition. So I usually put food on this sort of scale, and I go, like, what is the nutritional value of this food? Is it going to provide something valuable to my body, and what is in this food that could be potentially problematic? Is my body likely to react to this thing based on what I know about my health history? And then I sort of prioritize, okay, so if this food has some compelling nutrition but some problematic compounds, that's a food right there that I'm going to eliminate at first and then challenge and try to determine my individual tolerance. But as you can see, it's a really complex discussion because there's so many important nutrients in foods that we require awareness of to begin with, but there's also so many potentially problematic compounds in foods that also requires awareness to sort of understand the difference. And this is why I really feel that we can't simplify dietary frameworks to a one-size-fits-all, eat this, don't eat this. And instead, we really need to give people this broader education and the tools to figure this out. Like, I really don't want it to be intimidating. I want it to be empowering for people.
And so thank you for mentioning all that. And as you were speaking there, for the listeners, there's a really great book by Dr. Stephen Gundry called The Plant Paradox. Sarah, I'm sure you're familiar with that.
Yes.
And really, he's also big into the education behind foods and how they're sourced and kind of the ancestry of how and why we eat certain things going back, you know, to ancient cultures. And so, Sarah, one of the things you mentioned was the tomato lectin. So it made me think about, so for the listeners out there, you might try a whole tomato and, as you know, elimination and challenge and then react to that. And when it comes to the tomato lectins, the lectins are really in the skin and the seeds. So what if you then try tomato that you've skinned or that you've peeled and you've seeded and you're just eating the flesh, whether or not you still react to that? Like, it could get that detailed.
And it can get that detailed for a lot of different foods.
Yeah.
So the glycoalkaloids in potatoes are concentrated in the skin. Now I'm probably going to get this wrong. So with tomatoes, I believe there's more glycoalkaloids in it reverses. So green tomatoes versus ripe tomatoes. And I'm struggling to remember which one's which. More glycoalkaloids, I believe, in the green tomatoes, and that drops down as they get riper. And I believe tomato lectin does the opposite. So I believe tomato lectin increases as it gets riper. I might have that backwards. But sometimes it's also a question of, I can have this food when it's fully ripe, but not when it's green, or I can have this food when it's green and not when it's fully ripe. It can be, I try to encourage people to think of it as a fun discovery process, because it does take a long time to do this systematically. But then what you have at the end of it is you have this really detailed knowledge about how your body reacts to certain foods, and it may even get as detailed as, I can enjoy this food if I consume it once or twice a month, but if I have it more frequently than that, I start to notice joint pain or fatigue or mood issues or headaches, right? We've got all of these foods also that might not, our bodies might respond negatively to just enough that it makes that food okay for an occasional consumption, but not okay for regular consumption. We can get that detailed in terms of understanding our own bodies, and that becomes this really amazing information that helps us protect our own health for the rest of our lives. So it really is an important discovery process for all of us to go through.
So I like that word, discovery, because I know that the listeners right now, they're kind of like, what do I do next? Now I don't really know what to do. Well, you get Sarah's book, Paleo Principles, and you start reading that, and you could also read The Plant Paradox. But although it seems very daunting, that I also think it's very hopeful that if you have a negative response to a food, there might be ways to figure out, is it that food as its whole, or if you peel it, is it better? If you cook it, is it better? If it's in season or out of season, is it better? That there is hope as to try and figure out what works for you, the individual.
Absolutely.
So, Sarah, then where can our listeners find out more about you, and where can they get a copy of your book?
So Home Central for me is thepaleomom.com, and from there you can link to all of my social media sites, any projects that I'm working on. All four of my books are sold everywhere, so Amazon.com, BarnesandNoble.com, bookstores across America. Costco actually usually has at least one of my books in stock. So it's pretty easy to find, in a bookstore, but you can definitely get it on all the major online retailers as well. And in terms of learning about my, online courses, the one that's available now is called the Autoimmune Protocol Lecture Series. The next session starts, May 14th. There's a few sessions a year. And, you can also learn that about, you know, learn about that just by going to thepaleomom.com and scrolling down the homepage until you see the little banner about the course and clicking on that. It's a really robust education, on the diet and lifestyle aspects of the Autoimmune Protocol, but it includes a ton of practical tips and strategies and, a lot of, you know, just how to implement this in our homes. It includes information on refinement and troubleshooting, and it's really designed for the full spectrum in terms of experience with the Autoimmune Protocol. So everywhere from the person who's brand new to the idea of diet and lifestyle changes to manage chronic illness, all the way to the person who's been doing the Autoimmune Protocol for years and is just interested, thinks it's going great, or feels like they can refine it. It really has a ton of information for that entire spectrum and everybody in between. I've even had caregivers take the course and practitioners who are looking to start their advanced learning on the Autoimmune Protocol take the course. It really is a tremendous resource, and students absolutely love it. So that, again, you can find out more about that, my books, everything I do, links to social media at thepaleomom.com.
So for the listeners out there, I'll make sure that all of those resources, all of those links are in the podcast notes so that you can easily find all of the great information. Sarah,
thank you so much.
Sarah, thank you so much for being my special guest today. This has been another awesome interview.
I super appreciate coming back. I hope we're not capping this at three. I hope it's not a three strikes and you're out situation.
No, we'll call
Excellent.
It three plus to three infinity plus. And beyond.
There we go.
All right, this wraps up this very special episode of the Functional Medicine Radio Show with Sarah Ballantyne. And I want to thank you, our listeners, for tuning in today. And I'd like to invite you back next time for another episode of the Functional Medicine Radio Show. As always, I'm your host, Dr. Carrie Drisga, the Functional Medicine Doc. Have a great week, everyone.
You've been listening to the Functional Medicine Radio Show with your host, Dr. Carrie Drisga, known internationally as the Functional Medicine Doc. Dr. Carrie is committed to helping patients find the root cause of their health problems and fixing the cause with natural treatments so they can feel normal again. Dr. Carrie is the founder of Functional Medicine Ontario and is the author of the hit book, Reclaim Your Energy and Feel Normal Again. Please tell your friends about the Functional Medicine Radio Show, and we'll see you next week with more from Dr. Carrie.